Honorable Member for Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and as I reluctantly rise today, and reluctant not to represent the workers, but to have to be here today, I believe this repressive bill should never have been tabled. And as I said earlier in the debate, with this move, the government has shifted the race to the bottom into high gear. But I want to take a moment, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank my wife, and I'm going to try not to be emotional. Yesterday was our 11th wedding anniversary, and I was unable to be with her. But, Mr. Speaker, she understands the importance of my taking part in this debate, and, dear, I'll see you in a week or so. Another point I would like to make, Mr. Speaker, I am so proud of the fact of our Quebec caucus has made the significant sacrifice in giving up their important holiday, their chance to meet and enjoy St. John Baptiste Day with their constituents. I am sure the Quebecers who chose the MP Day in the election are also proud of their choice, because they see each and every one of that caucus in action in this House defending workers of the province of Quebec and Canada, and I want to thank them. Now, I spent 28 years in the labour movement, and this is very emotional for me. In 1988, I spent 17 and a half weeks on strike, so I decided to script myself, because if I don't, who knows what I might say. You know, with C6, the government has broken a tradition in this place, a tradition of balance. Mr. Speaker, with C6, the government has chosen to thumb their noses at the rights of the workers of Canada Post, workers who simply want to achieve a fair and balanced collective agreement. Mr. Speaker, I would suggest the remainder of Canada's workforce serving Canadians under the jurisdiction of this federal government need to be very concerned. Those same workers who ensure Canadians receive the services they need and deserve are now facing the most ideological-driven government in this country's history. There is a labour relations chill emanating from this government as a result of Bill C-6 that will be felt across this great country. But it will be felt the most in the homes and lives of good, hard-working Canadians. These Canadians thought that they could count on their federal government, a Conservative government, for a fair and even-handed approach in the times of significant labour disputes. Sadly, things have changed with Bill C-6, and today Canadian workers will begin to realize how wrong they have been about this Conservative government. Throughout this debate, I found just how terribly uninformed the Conservative members of Parliament are regarding the union's role in collective bargaining, their legal role. So I want to take a few moments to offer a Coles Notes version. In the process, and since you have to represent workers as well as employers, it might be worth your while to understand this. Prior to setting a national strategy for negotiations, all locals post bargaining proposal sheets on their union bulletin boards. These forms are used to seek their union membership's proposals for change to the collective agreement. You'll note, Mr. Speaker, I said proposals, not demands. These workers work under and within the terms of their collective agreement, and where they find shortcomings, they make proposals for change to their local union officers. An elected bargaining rep from the rank and file of the union compiles these proposals, as do all other locals across the bargaining unit. The union then holds a local meeting where all members can support or reject their co-workers' proposals. Those proposals that are passed at these meetings are forwarded to a central bargaining caucus. The local union bargaining representatives who are elected by their local attends this caucus, where all proposals from the local meetings are presented and prioritized and voted on by that full caucus. Following the bargaining caucus having set their package proposals to be presented to the employer, they then elect their bargaining team in whom they place their trust. The bargaining team shortly meets with the company and they exchange proposals, again, not demands or offers. Of course, in the media, the spin doctors call them workers' demands. And, of course, the other side is it's a company offer. Do you see the difference? It's already beginning. So now that I've set out the process for union member participation in the bargaining process, one important point that comes up repeatedly here is how the union gets a strike mandate. Unions hold secret ballot votes for their members, most in advance of ever presenting the proposals to the company. Some do a final after a final offer. Either way, it's a secret ballot vote. The wording of the ballot they usually use is, in voting yes, the membership authorized the bargaining committee to meet with the company, and failing to reach a collective agreement, they are authorized to take actions up and to including strike. The point, Mr. Speaker, this process is open and democratic from beginning to end. And more importantly, it clearly indicates the trust that the workers put in their bargaining committee. And for workers, the strike is the last vote, the last tool in the box. I would suggest in this debate, the uninformed government members have shown more of what they don't know about collective bargaining than what they do. This is especially true when we hear the old cliches, old union bosses. Well, I guess I'm an old union boss. I proudly serve my membership in Local 43 with the Communication Workers and later CEP for 28 years. I also was proud to say I was the longest serving president of the Hamilton District Labor Council, where we had 105 different local unions. In all of that time, Mr. Speaker, the workers trusted me, and I never lost a single motion because we were always honest with one another, and they never called me boss, they called me brother. Mr. Speaker, I trusted my members' judgment when they took positions at our meetings, and they trusted me. And as they said, they were the only boss in the room. So this has been a lengthy way to begin my intervention on C6 and the damage it does to all labor relations with this particular government. This bill clearly is first and foremost about the future of the workers at Canada's Post, or as we know them, the Posties. The very good, hard-working people that Canadians have entrusted to ensure delivery of our letters, cards, and packages for generations. Mr. Speaker, as you will hear often from the NDP in this place, these good, loyal workers have followed the rules. They have, in good faith, had their proposals for change to their collective agreement submitted to their employer. And throughout the bargaining process, their representatives have worked hard to resolve the matters at hand. In the bargaining process, there are few options for employees to ensure their proposals are given proper consideration by the employer. If workers deem the company is not taking their bargaining committee seriously, they can choose to work to rule, for instance. In this case, in a most responsible manner, instead of a full, all-out strike, CUPW decided to use rotating strikes to draw attention of the public and the government to their situation. They clearly were not trying not to overly inconvenience the public, and since they're not shutting down the whole system, they proved that point. During the impasse, the union had agreed to deliver essential mail, such as pension checks, etc. Again, not to inconvenience Canadians. So let's be very clear. It was Canada Post, the employer, who locked out the Posties. And even when the Posties had stopped the rotating strike, they had agreed to stop the rotating strikes and work under the old contract, Canada Post and this government said no. So to be very clear, you have to ask what's happening here. Why is the Conservative government so quick to trample the rights of Canadian workers? Clearly, Mr. Speaker, at least in my opinion, their ideology has overtaken them. Why else would they turn upside down the historical practices of this House? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Winnipeg South.
Speaker, it's truly an honour to rise in this debate and speak to this topic that we're discussing today. However, first I'd like to bring to the attention of the House some important news happening in Manitoba. I just wanted to announce that the NHL franchise will be called the Winnipeg Jets. Yeah. Very happy about that. I'm also going to talk, though, about this important debate, and I did listen to the member's speech. And my question is mostly focused on entrepreneurs and small business people that drive our economy. And I know back when I was an entrepreneur, I relied on the post quite often. In fact, every day you were expecting not only sales coming in, but also information and marketing going out. And so I have my primary question for this member is, does he not see the net benefit to our country, to the economy, by bringing about this action that our government has chosen to do? Does he not see that what we're actually going to accomplish through this bill will have a net benefit to our country and to our economy.
Absolutely.
The Honourable Member for Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member for his question. The only way it could be better is if the team came to Hamilton. But going directly to your question, it's not the fact that the government decided to force workers back to work. It's how fast they did. And the what appears to be, and I use the word appears to be, a complicity between Canada Post and this government for the lockout in the first place. May or may not be the case, but it's how quick that they moved, and the fact that they're legislating a worse offer than what this group has. It's breaking the traditions of this place. Why not trust the staff arbitrators that the Minister of Labour has at her disposal to settle this this dispute? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Halifax West.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm trying to think of what the link is between the labour stoppage at the post office and hockey, and all I can think of offhand is that that my shot is a bit more like regular mail than email. Best I can come up with is not all that fast, you know. But, Mr. Speaker, let me ask the Honourable Member, and I would agree it would be nice to see Hamilton have a hockey team, and it's great that Winnipeg's going to have an NHL team again. Next, of course, Toronto will want one, as they say, as the joke goes. But given given that, considering the fact that this, in my view, this legislation is, it presents an unbalanced system of arbitration, recognizing, of course, that when you have a lockout or a strike, even rotating strikes, there are impacts that are negative for the employer and the employees. Can the member, can he imagine, does he think it's possible to have an arbitration that is imposed where a fair result could actually be achieved?
The Honourable Member for Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. In the collective bargaining process, there are provisions for an arbitrator to make a ruling on this final disposition of collective bargaining. And it's important that in our country that the government allows that to proceed without a heavy-handed approach. Canadian workers, by the way, when they're on strike, the letter carriers aren't just like the people who are not getting the letters. The letter carriers aren't getting a paycheck. Nobody wants to be on strike. And the reality is it's not good for anybody. So why don't the government side listen to the proposals that have come from our leader, the member for Toronto, Danforth, and help us come together so that we can resolve this situation?
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Nanaimo-Cowichan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Hamilton East Stony Creek, and he very ably outlined some of the process in collective bargaining, and I have an email here that says, we at CUPW took a vote to ratify our demands pre-negotiation. We then debated these demands at two levels, locally and regionally, and voted on each one. Our members then got a strike vote, 94.5%, the highest vote ever, highest turnout ever. And we gave our National Executive Board the authority to vote on our behalf and gave us the opportunity to vote on an offer. And when they vote on that, the contract is adequate enough for us to vote on. So on. And they go and talk about the postal workers themselves are not in favour of this lockout. They offered to stay at work and continue to negotiate. And I wonder if the member could comment on that process within a collective bargaining unit.
The Honourable Member for Hamilton East and Stony Creek.
Well, I have a little bit of experience I would like to talk about. In 1988, I was on the bargaining committee for the communication workers with Bell Canada. We'd negotiate every day for 9 months, and then we had a 17-and-a-half-week strike. So I understand very clearly the seriousness of this situation. But it is a democratic process. It is an open process, contrary to what is said. And I'd just like to thank the member for her question.